we went for our mid-year retreat to Thelonia Barefoot. And when we spent like about 5 days in Thelonia, we realized that, you know, there are so many like self-help groups and, you know, artisans who are basically coming together using the kind of skills that they have, the art forms that they know of, to make like these beautiful products that they are very proudly selling to the external stakeholders. From then to now, from it being like a platform for skilling and like a learning center for the children, to now it being a full-fledged organization that has a very holistic model that focuses on financially empowering women. And how we choose to do that is by giving them access to a lot of knowledge pieces that they struggle with, like micro level knowledge pieces that kind of are missing in their current reality, that kind of stop them from making informed choices. For example, financial literacy, management, a lot of knowledge in terms of health, sanitation. So that's one of the core things that we prioritize. The other thing that we kind of prioritize is their skilling. So we provide like a platform where they could learn multiple skills from dyeing to like tailoring, to candle making, stuff that they can immediately convert into money. And the third is the livelihood project, in which like a group of artisans basically come together to make products that are then sold through corporate channels. Before this, they weren't involved in any other kind of economic activity. Majority of them used to even stitch clothes for themselves or their family members, but that wasn't leading to any kind of income generation. And I think that was something that they really wanted to explore, but they wanted to do it in a safer space, which their family won't be against. Because initially there were a lot of like kind of, I wouldn't say that the husbands or the in-laws were 100% supportive of their daughter-in-laws or wives walking out and suddenly doing like a full-time job. Now I think their motivation has changed to them actually seeing hardcore results, you know. Now when they're earning that, you know, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 rupees in their hands every month, and they can see how that has changed their husband's attitude towards them, how that has changed their children's attitude towards them, the amount of money that the mothers, you know, channelize towards their kids' education. A lot of kids clearing Pratibha exams. Like, that's a conversation that we have constantly with the mothers, even if their kids are in like first grade or second grade, that, you know, you need to constantly think about the long-term picture, about how can you send your kids off to like the Pratibha schools, which are considered to be the best government schools in Delhi. So I think, yeah, in the last 2 years, we've seen like a lot of TFI kids getting that opportunity, that prestigious opportunity to go into like a Pratibha school. And that also requires like a lot of parental support, because a lot of the times it's easy for parents to kind of accept the reality that I want my kid to keep studying in a TFI classroom. You know, it's the most comfortable option for me. Why should I put in extra effort to kind of, you know, make my kid travel that far, you know, pay like fees for like his or her transport, right, on an everyday basis? But because the parents are kind of invested in that, that's happening. In Himani's class, like, there are so many student leaders, right? Like, for that matter, kids being a part of Ubuntu, kids being a part of like KER, kids doing the learning circles within the community. I think that is something that has happened. I wouldn't say solely because of the parents, but they've played like a crucial role in the picture. For example, even the learning circles, right? Like, the parents need to constantly give permissions to the kids to, you know, go to each other's homes, because a lot of parents are very, very scared about the safety of their kids, right? But for them to be okay with their kids traveling, going to each other's homes every single day and just like studying together, you know, teaching each other. A lot of parents are also very like concerned about, you know, them, their kids, if their kids are like performing, like well-performing kids, then why should they spend time on teaching other kids? Right, they have their own siblings to teach, right? But like over the years, I've seen the parents being okay with their kids, you know, teaching like say 10 other kids of the community, and them taking a lot of pride in it. First thinking about even sending kids to college for that matter, right? Or maybe if the kid fails in ninth grade, not letting the kid to drop out of the system, because these are like problems that we see happening with every other family in Mandavli. That when kids fail like a few times in ninth grade, they immediately like, you know, drop out of the system, because the parents also kind of give up. Or like, especially for girls, like post 10th grade, not a lot of girls in the community continue their education, because, you know, there's always this thing of, it's okay, like she studied up to 10th, let her like learn, be a part of some vocational course, and she'll figure out like, you know, how to work for her own self or at home. And that's the kind of attitude that we kind of got exposed to initially when we started having those conversations, because the mothers themselves haven't completed their education. they've studied up to like, say, you know, 6th grade or 8th grade or 10th grade. And that's the kind of vision that they had for their children, that if I have studied till 8th grade, okay, my daughter will complete maybe 12th grade, you know, and that's it. And that's what we want to change, because majority of the kids in the community, like very, very few of them go for like a full-time regular college. Either majority of the kids drop out, or they prefer like open schooling, or like, you know, doing college through correspondence, which is great in its own way if done properly. But otherwise, there's a very high risk of kids dropping out of the system. And hence, I believe that that's where like a parent, if he or she has the right kind of knowledge, has the right kind of skills, knows what the kid, you know, what's best for the kid, is able to kind of identify what the kid is interested in, actually is able to support the kid to kind of attain his or her true potential. And hence it's really important for them to kind of have that decision making skill. We kind of operate with that belief that parents don't need to know every single thing that's written in your textbooks to be able to support you. But a couple of things that our parents did for us that kind of showed us that they believe in us and they believe in our education is simple things like them going for PTM meetings, right? Staying in touch with the teacher, asking the teacher lots of doubts in terms of, if the kid is not performing well, how am I supposed to support the kid at home, you know? Sending the kids to right tuitions if the kid is not able to get enough support from school, right? Providing the kid with good resources in terms of reading materials or touch and feel, you know, activities or whatever that helps the kid to perform better in school. And our parents were able to do that for us. And I feel that that's the kind of conversation that we have with the mothers, that, you know, initially it was a lot to do with English. That, Didi, you know, you teach our kids in English and we don't understand that language and hence we can't teach them. So how do you expect us to support them? But I think the conversation needs to be around, and it has been around, whether you're going for PTM meetings, you know, are you applying for the SMC, the school management committee? Are you actively attending the meetings? Are you raising certain topics or certain issues in school? For example, if the teacher is being absent for more than, you know, a week, then are you questioning the school authority that why is the teacher being absent, you know? If your students or your children's notebooks are not being checked in school, then are you raising that as a concern? Context in the initial few months, it's so important to have that context of each and every kid in your classroom, the kind of backgrounds that each and every kid comes from. And I feel that once you have that information, like, fellows are sorted. Like, it helps them to an extremely great extent. Like, if I think about the kind of role that I would like to believe that I played for Himani, was that in the first 2 months, I hope that I helped her to gain that context. To be a community enabler, like, I feel that, like, there's no one right way of doing it, or there's no one right, like, mindset or skill or knowledge that the person needs to operate with. Different things work for different people. So I'll just share what worked for me. Personally, I think one, in terms of the mindset, like I said, right? Like, just being aware of myself, my core value, and finding that one motivation that helps me to kind of stay connected with the community. I think everyone's reason for staying connected to the community is very, very different. Like, a person who wants to work in the community needs to find that piece of motivation for himself or herself. For me, it was respect. It was empathy. It was just extreme amount of genuineness in the community. People don't fake it, you know. They are very vulnerable about their ideas. They're very vulnerable about their problems. And that's the kind of person I am. And hence, I kind of connected with the community at a much more personal level. But for different people, for example, I know that there are some community aggregators who kind of, you know, become motivated to work in the community because, they want to kind of fix one problem that they're seeing that they're extremely close to. For example, you know, people being very, very close to the fact of, say, student leadership, or people being very, you know, attached to the whole aspect of environment, you know, and how they want the community to become like a much better space for the people living in that area, right? So for different people, different motivations work. I think just to be a community enabler, it's very important for you to find that motivation for yourself. The second, in terms of mindset, I feel it's just being persistent and not giving up. Because a lot of the things that you do, you don't see tangible outputs every single day, right? And it might take you like a year, 2 years, 3 years to see like a small change happen. And I think that's the biggest thing that I've learned, that it's okay if things are uncertain. It's okay to work in that kind of ambiguous space. Because I, as a person, used to like having some amount of control in the kind of workspace that I was a part of, and it used to bug me as a person if I am putting in X amount of input and if I couldn't see by amount of output. But I think just being in the space since the last 2-3 years, like, I know that my efforts need to be prioritized, my outputs need to be more effort driven, because that's the only thing that I can control as a person. I don't have 100% control over what will happen in the community if I'll do this. So I think just being persistent, not giving up so soon, and being okay with the ambiguity that's there, but also continuously questioning yourself that what is the kind of effort that you're putting in into the process. In terms of skill, I think I would suggest just very, very strong communication skills, which doesn't depend on any one language, whatever works for you, but just being okay with communicating with people and actually enjoying that, you know, asking questions, talking to people, understanding their history, sharing your, you know, views, your take on things, and just, you know, loving just being around people, talking to them, because not a lot of people do that, you know. And the only way one can survive in this kind of space if you actually genuinely love having conversations with people and if you're good at it. The other skill would be just in terms of zooming out and zooming in constantly, you know, maintaining a balance of that. Because there are a lot of times when you're working on a project and it's like, okay, I'll do this, this will happen, these number of kids will be a part of this, or these number of players will be a part of this. But constantly zooming out and looking at the bigger ecosystem and asking yourself, by me doing this, what's the kind of impact will happen on the larger ecosystem, or how will the larger ecosystem play like an important part of the smaller thing that I'm a part of? Who are the other players in the system who can contribute to this in a much more effective way than I can? So just zooming out and zooming in constantly, keeping, you know, the larger ecosystem into consideration, I think it's extremely, extremely important. In terms of knowledge, I think the only knowledge that will help you to do this is having enough context of the community. There's no book that I would suggest, there's no article that I would suggest, because we've seen so many great community leaders not having any kind of formal education, but still being able to create such strong social movements, right? Or who are able to kind of generate so much love and impact within a community space. And hence, there's no specific information or knowledge that I would want people to walk in with, but just them wanting to constantly understand the history of the community, the present and the future beliefs and aspirations of the people. Just the alums being super active in Delhi city, like, I definitely agree, like, a lot of alums have kind of set up, you know, their organizations within the ETH space specifically. What that has led to is just like kids across the city having just more options in terms of support. There are so many other organizations, for example, Slam Out Loud, like Prayogshala. And I feel that our kids are just like lucky, you know, to have access to such a strong ecosystem where whatever they demand for, like, there's one alum who's working on that puzzle piece and is more than happy to kind of collaborate with the TFI fellows to kind of get those opportunities to the classrooms. So yeah, so I think just the whole alum puzzle piece and the TFI city's, you know, inclination towards leveraging the communities for better student outputs, I feel the both bets are extremely strong in nature. They are sustainable, they are long lasting. At the same time, they will have an impact on students over a longer period of time. For example, Aloho Mora, that works with, like, you know, secondary school kids and supports them in identifying their individual passions. They're doing such an incredible job in, like, certain parts of North Delhi and in certain parts of South Delhi. Like, the kids who have now finished 12th grade, they are actually linking those kids with, like, employment opportunities as well. And that's such an incredible thing for our kids, right? Like, them having access to such kind of opportunities immediately after school. So I'm just very excited when I think about the entire ecosystem.